Good morning and welcome to our hangout. I'm Staff Sergeant Sarah Schramborg of the United States Army Field Band, and we're so excited to be working with the Wayne State University Brass Pedagogy class taught by Dr. Wendy Matthews out in Detroit, Michigan today. How are you guys doing? You sound excited. We're really excited too. So we have one of our brass quintets here today, the Chamber Brass, and one of our arranging staff members that are going to help you guys with your brass pedagogy and arranging techniques. I heard that you guys have been studying these secondary instruments for only one semester, is that right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, great. Well, that's going to be, look, we've all been there, and it's going to be, we're really excited. So why don't we get started with the Chamber Brass playing a short piece by Handel.
Thank you very much, everyone. How are we doing out at Wayne State? We're doing great. Well, I am Master Sergeant Michael Klima, and we are the Chamber Brass, and we are actually one of about a dozen chamber groups that come out of the Army Field Band's concert band. And a big part of our job not only is to travel the country and represent soldiers and telling the Army's story, but we also take these chamber groups out to colleges, just like your own, all the way down to elementary schools, and try to give them a little bit back of what we've had in our lives. I think we all know we've had certain teachers in our lives that really made a difference in our musical career. So this is kind of a really important part of our job, very personally. We love the educational aspect of it. So let's just quick introduce everyone here, just to make sure you make this a little more personal. Like I said, I am Master Sergeant Mike Klima. I'm originally from Sartell, Minnesota, and I've been in the field band about 15 years.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Sergeant First Class Nick Althaus. I'm from Salem, Ohio, Northeast Ohio, and I've been with the Army Field Band. I'm looking at the camera now. The Army Field Band about 7 years.
All right, good morning. My name is Staff Sergeant Rebecca McLaughlin. I'm the French horn player in the concert band, and I've been in the Army Field Band for a little over 2 years now. I started out in the regular bands with the 8th Army Band in Seoul, Korea, and I'm from Columbia, Maryland.
Hi there, I'm Master Sergeant Matthew Nelson. I've been in the Army Field Band a little over 13 years, and I'm originally from Oconomowoc, Wisconsin.
Good morning, everyone. I am Sergeant First Class Todd Sterniolo. I'm originally from Hagerstown, Maryland. I play the trombone in the concert band, and I've been here in the band for about 11 years now.
Good
Good morning, everyone. I'm one of the staff rangers at the field band. My name is Sergeant First Class Adrian Hernandez. I've been here for 7 years and originally from Dallas, Texas. So I believe now we're going to go ahead and start off with the first arrangement, and we'll go from there.
Allegretto, Philip Sylvester, are you there?
Yeah, right here.
All right. Do you have anything quick to input about your piece at all?
Not really.
Okay, well, we're going to go ahead and play it, and then we'll give a little feedback here, and we'll see how we do.
Right, thank you.
Well, Philip, I want to say that's a great arrangement. You've got a lot of good things, and I'll go ahead and start off with some of the better, a lot of things I've noticed, which is really important, is there's a lot of changes in texture. It's real easy for a beginning arranger to want to use all of the ensemble all the time. And in this arrangement, what's really great is you're not afraid to use solos in unison. You're not afraid to have a line by itself or give it to a single instrument. What's also great is that you really save those big moments for the bigger part of the piece, and you can really hear the form and how it develops through it. Some of the things I will point out maybe that you might want to try is you do have the tuba up in the higher register, which is great. It's a nice effect, but you really don't really use the bottom end very much. So maybe you might want to try experimenting with that, bringing in more of that foundation, maybe have more of the doubling with the trombone to kind of give a little more weight to the ensemble. And also what's also good would maybe a better setup as far as a layout. There's not any rehearsal marks, so maybe if they wanted to go back and rehearse something, they might want to touch up it would be easier to have something to resource to. And then also with tempos, you've got the tempo mark at the beginning, but when the maestoso, maybe you might want to be a little more direct in telling them how much slower and how much faster you want to do. And now I'll revert back to the ensemble. Maybe they'll have some more specific things they want to say in regards to their parts.
All right, Philip. My name is Staff Sergeant Rebecca McLaughlin, as I said before. I'm going to talk a little bit about your horn part. This is a lot of playing in the higher range of the horn, and I love that you're willing to use that, but for younger players, that might be a little tiring. So I would suggest maybe taking some of these notes or even full sections down a full octave that puts it back into the staff, and that might be really helpful. Also, in the maestoso section, a couple different arrangers did this as well, so this applies to everyone in the room. when you look at the horn part, it starts on an A above the staff, R-A. And for a beginning player, an intermediate player, and even an advanced player like myself, that's pretty difficult to do. The horn has lots of notes up there in the harmonic series that are really, really close together. So unless you hear that note before you start playing it, as I'm sure you realized as a horn player practicing just in the past couple months and learning the instrument, it's hard to pick those out. So I would suggest either taking those parts down a little bit or thinking about working your way up to those high notes. The last thing is on French horn, because a lot of the notes are really close together, they have similar fingerings, and when you're going from R-E in the staff at the top to an F-sharp at the top of the staff, it's the same fingering. That's called a lip slur, so you're slurring a lot between the same fingering just using your embouchure, and that's also really difficult. So if you know the instrument really well, you'd know, oh, that's really hard to do, maybe I should either take that down the octave or put it in a different part or understand just the intricacies of the instrument. So those are a couple of things I'd say about the piece. Other than that, I love listening to it and playing it. Thank you so much for sending it in, and I'll pass it along to our tuba player, Sergeant Nelson.
Thank you.
I just have a couple things to say. I second what Sergeant McLaughlin said on the horn part. With the tuba part in general, you could take the whole thing down one octave, the whole thing. And the other thing I was going to think about, when you're writing high for the tuba and it's really soft, you got to be careful, because when you write, you want your players to be successful. And when I was playing this part, I was crossing my fingers, like, oh, I hope I hit this high C, you know. So you know, if it's a little higher and it's the dynamic is a little louder, then, you know, that's fine. But when you're getting into like the soft, really delicate stuff, keep it in like the really money range of the tuba. All right. And that's all I have. Thanks.
Thank you.
I think we're ready to hear you guys play. Can you introduce your piece and let's hear something?
Thank you very much.
Jenny, you want to introduce your piece?
It's back.
Come on.
Yeah. Okay. So this is a cover of Beauty and the Beast.
What's your name?
And I'm Becca Self. And I am on trumpet, but my primary instrument is harp.
Okay, are you doing
it? And your voice.
Thank you.
right, awesome. I can't imagine playing another instrument right now that I have no clue on. You guys are doing a great job. As far as a brass pedagogy aspect, I think I'm going to say two little things to you, especially for younger kids. I noticed you're doing some bell movement, right? Kind of keeping it all together. You can probably even do a little bit more eye contact and breathe together. See if you can really make contact. I think that'll join everything together a little bit better. But the other thing was, when you teach some young kids, think about the airstream a little bit more. A lot of these melodies that you had were nice lyric long melodies. Think of singing it. How would you sing it? La da da dee dee, la da 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 da. Very connected. So you have to think of the airstream as doing that same thing. I know there's a lot to think of. We've got different positions and fingers and things like that going on, but that's kind of the underlying thing you have to really think about with brass playing, is kind of try to emulate a voice, at least a lot of times. I think you'll really find out your tone will develop. It'll just be a lot smoother. So does anyone else have anything you'd like to come on up?
All right, first of all, I want to say thank you so much for playing that for us. That's a really hard thing to do, and I'm glad you got up the courage. So one thing I'd like to mention, as a brass player, is we have to worry about articulation and note accuracy, and I'm sure those are questions that are always floating around in your minds when it comes to playing a brass instrument. Well, for me, articulation has a couple buzzwords I want you to think about. One is a wall of sound. So once you articulate the note starts immediately after that. There's no air, there's no fuzziness, there's nothing in between. So when you articulate and you're supporting all of the air right behind your tongue, that note should start immediately. And so if you get that buzz right away, you get an immediate wall of sound right away, then you should be able to continue on with that note. So there's no space in between when your tongue articulates and then when the note actually starts. So the second thing with articulating is there are lots of different ways to articulate, lots of different sounds you can make, accents and legato sounds. So I want you to think about different positions that your tongue can make in your mouth. And everyone is different. Everyone is physically different. So there are different places where you may be placing things. I personally think about the difference between right behind my teeth, maybe where your teeth meet your gums, a little bit higher, maybe a little bit lower, maybe a la or a ta or a da, all those different sounds you can make. So when you're starting out new musicians, you can give them lots of different options, and hopefully they'll start to experiment and learn what works best for them. So that was my feedback on articulation. I think next we're going to be performing I'll Be There For You, which is an arrangement without French horn, so I'll stand to the side, and I think we're ready to go. Thanks.
Awesome job, Madison. It's a lot of energy, and that's definitely one of the strong points about it. It's the, you know, the band's always constantly moving, and it's a lot to work with just four instruments, to kind of divide that up between them and not really kind of limited on textures. But one thing I will notice, I would kind of watch at the beginning how low the trombone and tuba is. It kind of makes it a little muddy, but it's great that you're really work, you know, kind of just experimenting and really just using the rhythms to drive the band. And once again, like the other arrangement, I would go ahead and put in those rehearsal marks in case they wanted to go back. Layout's very important. It helps efficiency in rehearsal, and it really helps build confidence in parts where people can kind of see where the phrase starts and where it ends. And you need that confidence when somebody's reading a chart for the first time. But great job. I'll go ahead and revert to the musicians on individual parts.
Yeah, I'll say something.
Sure. Hi, very nice job in writing this. I would say that on the trombone part, you know, you hear that the real iconic opening. Dum, da, 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 dum, da, 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 dum. Well, I just sang it up an octave from where it's played. Like Adrian said, down an octave, it is really muddy. And if it were up an octave, especially for a beginner player, it would be easier to play and more noticeable or more recognizable by the ear. But nice job, though.
Just a couple quick notes, and this goes for a lot of the arrangements that we had. There's kind of minimal information on the page. We have a lot of notes, but I'm looking at mine. I don't have any tempo indication, no dynamics, no articulations, just the notes. So maybe think of how you want it to sound and try to add those details in for the performer, especially if it's a this is a pretty familiar tune to a lot of us, but if we don't know the song at all or the tune, we may not know how to approach it. And those little articulation markings and other dynamics might help us in our performance. So keep that in mind too with your young students. Thanks.
All right, let's move right along. One more of yours, right?
Yep.
All right, this is mine. I made it. It's an original piece. It's not an arrangement, but not much else to it. So. Thank you.
awesome piece that had a lot of mood and character to it. I think that's probably a really strong point of it. I think once you get it all together and you continue practicing, you're going to hear it kind of blossom, and the those harmonies are going to be really beautiful. Something I wanted to just touch on a little bit with everyone when teaching young students, I think the number one thing we always have to start with is tone production, right? We always want to have a beautiful sound, because no one's going to want to listen to us, even if we can play all the fingers. If it doesn't sound good, it's not going to be pleasing to the ear. So with young students, I think you should try something with just your mouthpiece. Have you ever practiced with your mouthpiece yet?
Yes.
Yeah. It's a starting point, isn't it? Because, I mean, basically, what is this?
An extension of the
I mean, that's just a big amplifier, right? So we have to put in a really good product. So I'm going to have you all do this with me real quick, just a quick little exercise. It's just kind of a breathing and a buzzing exercise. And basically, I like to tell my young students, don't even think about buzzing. It should be a byproduct. It'll just happen if everything's working correctly. So everyone take off your mouthpiece and just take a deep breath and just blow into the center of your mouthpiece, a nice big fat column of air, okay, a nice big breath. Ready? Okay, this is really easy. Okay, we're going to try to replicate that now, blowing into the mouthpiece, but not buzzing. Just a big, fat column of air. How much air can you get out of that stem? Ready? There you go. Really easy, okay? Now, what would happen if I blow that same amount of air but start focusing my lips? Yeah. So there's going to be a balancing point. Once my lips get to a certain point, they're going to start vibrating on their own. I'm not going to actually physically have to make my lips buzz. I think when you think about that, you actually add some tension. So if you think, I got a buzz right here, and it gets really tight or small, I'm actually just going to blow it into a buzz like this. Can you all try that? Just a nice big fat column of air. Start focusing and keep blowing right until it buzzes, until it sounds nice and big and round. Ready? Yeah, any old note, nice and low, even, you know, really, really relaxed. But that's the part, you'll notice that it all of a sudden got louder. Right when you hit that sweet spot, you'll find out just how much focus you need. You don't need to go past that point, because if you go past that point, it's just going to get smaller and more tight and sharp. So think about that when you first pick up your instrument. What's the most beautiful sound I can make, but also the most relaxed sound? We want this part to be easy, because brass playing, even for us in general, it's not an easy task. It's an athletic event sometimes. So we want to make it as efficient as possible. Okay. So that's just my one little thing about teaching brass and also applying it to yourself. Just think about the ease of what happens here before we even start putting all the technical things and the physical things together. All right?
Hello again. I want to talk a little bit about warming up and the importance of warming up, especially for brass playing in general. When we're using our lips and our embouchure, we're using those muscles, and they have the tendency to get really tired, to wear out really easily, which is why brass players can't just play for 8 hours straight. We need some time. We need to let blood flow happen in the embouchure. So when you warm up, it's really key to be playing long notes, middle of the range, lower range, getting everything moving, getting everything buzzing, just as if you were an athlete. You wouldn't just start running sprints. You'd run a little bit, stretch a little bit, move around, and then continue on. So I'm sure you experienced, if you've just been sitting there cold, or in an ensemble setting, if you've just been counting 80 measures of rest, then you go to play again and everything kind of, it doesn't really work yet. So when you start out your ensembles, it's good to have an understanding of, brass musicians need a little bit of time. They need to warm up. They need to really kind of get all the kinks out in the morning, and then they can start playing a little bit better. So also with that, I want to talk about kind of the same thing, warming up, warm sounds, and warm air. When you play a woodwind instrument, I don't know if we have any majors in a woodwind instrument, it's cool air and you're blowing like you're blowing out a candle. When it's a brass instrument, it's hot air, like you're sighing or like you're trying to fog up a window. So if your hand was a window, it's that same type of air, only focused. So also similar to sighing. that very open, open throat type of air. So those are a couple of things. Hopefully they can help you when you're practicing and help your students when you help them learn to play. So next we will be playing the arrangement called Dances for Spain. And who is that by? That is by John George. Can you raise your hand? You here today? Great. John, all right, we're going to play your arrangement next.
John, what a fabulous job on this one. I would say the very strong thing about this arrangement, if you were to take away all the dynamics in their parts, I can guarantee you you'll still get the same effect because that's how it's orchestrated. You have orchestrated the dynamics, and I think that's what makes it very effective. You've got style marks, you've got a lot of information for them to absorb, and I think that's why you got a really good performance out of it. Something I'd be mindful of when it comes to the kind of counterpoint music, with all the accidentals, it's really good idea to include courtesies, especially if the note comes up very soon afterwards, because sometimes it can get confusing, so it's good to anticipate those things and in order to make sure they get it on the first read. But overall, very good. I really love changing the role of the French horn and giving it more of that accompaniment lower end right there at B. So that's a nice little change, and it gives a little more excitement when the tuba comes back in that same role accompanying. So overall, very good job.
All right, we're going to move on back to you guys. What do we have?
So the ranger can get the Good morning. I'm Stephanie Antrikin. I'm playing tuba, but my main instrument is flute. And I did an arrangement of Mr. Sandman by the Cordettes, and I hope you like it.
Well, first of all, I love that song. Secondly, I need to give props to the horn player because they were just rocking out back there. You did so well. I'm really impressed with that part, not only that you wrote it out for someone, but that you were able to run with it and play that. That's really difficult. As a brass musician, and this goes for every single instrument, not just French horn, ear training is so key. If you can pick out the intervals, if you can hear the notes ahead of time, if you can sing them, then you'll most likely be able to center the note a little bit better than if you hadn't heard it in your head before. So with a line like that in arpeggiated, dun, 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 if you can hear all of those, if you can sing all those intervals, most likely you can start to work it out on your instrument. Also, I want to talk a little bit about partials. On the French horn, once you get a little bit higher in the harmonic series, they get closer together. And so as you get higher and higher up there, there's more of a chance for you to miss notes. And so that ear training is so important. And I'm really impressed with your horn player. It sounds like she really knew that part and was really working on it. So way to go with that arrangement. It sounds really great, and keep at it. And I think I'm going to hand it over to our tuba player again, Sergeant Nelson.
Now, usually when I go into, or the quintet goes into different high schools and stuff, I'm in charge of doing the breathing clinic, okay? Now, it is so important that you stay relaxed and you get the biggest breath and a relaxed exhale as possible, okay? Now, bear with me, but do this exercise with me. When I say go, let out all the air that you possibly can out of your lungs and hold it. And then when I say go again, try to squeeze out just a little bit more air, and we're gonna hold it for 10 seconds. And then when I say go again, I want you to take a nice deep breath in. And hopefully you have that feeling of a very big, relaxed breath. Okay, here we go. When I say go, let out all the air that you possibly can. Go. Hold it. Let out a little bit more. Hold it. 10 seconds, here we go. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, breathe. Okay. That's just a simple thing that, you know, when you're warming up, when you're getting ready to play, you know, I know you guys are probably nervous. You're not used to playing your instrument, but just do these breathing exercises, okay? Get relaxed. Realize what a nice big breath is, okay? So you can keep your whole body relaxed, because if you're tense, it's so hard to play a brass instrument, okay? Now, one more thing. Let's do the opposite exercise. Take in as much air as you can, and then hold it, and then we'll try to take in a little bit more, and then we're going to let it out. That's how the exhale should feel, okay? Go. Hold it. Take a little more. Hold it. 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Let it out. Okay, two simple exercises to show you what a nice relaxed breath in and breath out is, and I guarantee your playing will improve just that much more just by doing that. So, moving on.
All right, back to one of your arrangements, When I'm Gone, Gone, Gone. Sarah Noble, are you in the audience? There you are. Okay, here we go.
Awesome job, Sarah. What I love about this, you're not afraid to use the solos. It's a very, very good tool to have in a ranger's toolbox. Just be sure, and it's good for the instrumentalists, is to maybe notate that for them, to let them know you're going to be the only one playing, because I'm sure they might feel they're making a mistake. And then also, when the trombone comes in, maybe let them know you're playing with the trumpet, and the trumpet knows the trombone's coming with them. So it helps kind of do the reading through the reading process. But you've got a lot of good rhythmic variety. It's very good to have all that high energy, because you don't have the pop group behind you. You just have five instrumentalists. So very good job. Just make sure you convey all the information with the dynamics and the score, and also give, you know, set them up with some rehearsal marks so they can have somewhere to go back to when they want to rehearse. If anybody else has any other remarks, I'll go ahead and get back to the musicians.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think I would just reiterate what Sergeant Hernandez says, is that a little bit more dynamics and some articulation things. I mean, you could probably really find out where you can just delicately come in and then boom, pop it off and then right back. It would just help shape it. I actually told my group, play everything that's on the page. Don't try to be musicians and interpret anything. So what you see is what you get. So that'll help a little bit. Do we want to do a little question-answer session? We've been playing and going back and forth, but maybe we can get a little bit of ideas of things you might have some concerns about brass playing, anything about we do as our job. Anyone out there?
Actually,
The first thing I'd like for you guys to say, is there anything, as these guys are going to be teachers and most of them are not brass players, anything that you wished a middle school or high school teacher would have given you or done for you, and maybe something that kind of messed up for you?
Well, I don't have anything that messed up, but I do know there are not very many French horn players out there who are band directors. And so one of the things that is kind of an enigma when you're picking up a French horn for the first time is, where on earth does my hand go in this bell? It's such a huge bell, and I have a very little hand, so what do I do? Well, the point is to not cut off the sound, but we want to have space. Oh, the microphone's in the way. I'm sorry. I want to have space for the sound to get out. So my hand is actually pretty flattened out. Let me see if I can get that. See it? All right. And that should be able to allow some sound to go out. If your hand starts to cup like this, or if your fingers are spread, that's all getting in the way of the sound. So try to keep it nice and a very flattened out shape. And then when you put it in the bell, I want you to think about how the sound can get by so that it doesn't hinder anything. Also, we wear long sleeves when we perform, but when I was first starting out, I was told try to avoid wearing long sleeves because that'll also muffle the sounds. French horn can tend to sound a little muffled and covered up, and we don't want it to sound like that. We want it to be open and clear and project. Also, how many people have practiced stopped horn? It's when you see in your part a little cross over the note, which means you need to cover up the sound. What that means with your hand is you're trying to close as much of the bell off as possible without just sticking your hand all the way in. So what you do is you use your hand like a little hinge, you close it off, and you try to cover up all of the air so that when you play, it ends up sounding like it's muted. So if you're just playing a regular horn and your hand is out of the bell, but when you stop, you close your hand on in. I also play the same fingering so you can hear when you stop the horn, it raises the pitch. So that's something to also be aware about. You're making the horn shorter when you stop the sound, so it gets a little bit higher. It gets a half step higher. So when you're teaching your students, those were two things that I remember my band directors just kind of said, ask your private teacher, he'll figure it out. Well, hopefully now you'll be able to pass that on. You'll know where the hand can go in the bell and also how to stop your hand so that you get that muted sound. So those are a few things for French horn. Do we have another instrument? All right, Sergeant Sterniello on trombone.
All right, hello again. One thing I wish my band director had told everyone was how important it is to have private lessons. Make sure you impress that on your students, especially the ones that really have that shining talent, that they get private lessons. It's just the one-on-one interaction that you get with a private teacher who really knows everything, the ins and outs of your instrument, can really make them blossom. And beyond that, also encourage your students to listen to good music. Turn off some of the stuff that's on the radio. Go out and get some good CDs, even old vinyl. It just has a certain warmth. But make sure you get good recordings of things to listen to. A good model is always a good thing to aspire to be. And without that model, you really don't know where you're going. So, you know, impress on your students to do that.
And another thing to maybe take into consideration as being non-brass players is with the younger students, have a very balanced, progressive approach to their growth. It's easy to work on breathing exercises, getting to move the air, and you know they can move a lot of air pretty young. But unless the strength is keeping up there, and it can get out of balancing and blow their chops out. So progressively build them up, especially with the upper brass instruments, the range. Make sure they're playing with a good controlled sound before you give them anything that's too challenging that's going to be stressing them in the upper register. And beyond that, to help build the strength, just lots of playing in easy situations, give them that confidence that they need. Another good confidence builder is small groups like brass quintet or even duos and trios. Same instrument, you do trios and quartets. There's a lot of easy literature out there that would be fun for them to interact with peers at the same level. Give them more reps, build that strength, and give them the confidence. So very progressive approach to that. Thanks.
And I'll add one more quick little thing, enthusiasm. I had a middle school band director who was old, he was tired, it rubbed off on everyone. Band wasn't all that fun. He retired and we got a brand new band director. He was great, he took an extra time, and the band just, I mean, you could just watch it rise, and the morale. I mean, it was really important. So what you bring to it, you'll see in your students, I think. It's a big part of it. And also talking about, Sergeant Sterniolo mentioned about listening. Listening to a lot of recordings, and you can also go to our website, which is www.armyfieldband.com, so that's all one word, and you can listen to a lot of, you actually download some of the recordings, and you can stream a lot of our albums, just to get a variety of things there, so it's all free. Really good resource that we put up there. What's that?
Educational videos.
And we also have the educational videos, which I believe most of you have watched. You've seen some of our brass resources up there too. So, all right, another question. We spent a lot of time on that one. Anyone else?
Can you tell us a little bit about how you each chose the instrument that you're playing? Like, how did you fall in love with it? How did you decide that was the one for you?
Boy, that's a question we get a lot when we go into high school. They always ask that question. How do you, you know, you're so good now. Why did you do that? Well, mine was pretty straightforward. My older brother played the cornet and the trumpet, was very good at it. And there was this cornet sitting in the closet. So I tried that and I never went back. I just loved it. And that's where I've gone. Anyone else?
Pretty similar story with me. My father had started out on cornet, and my grandfather was a cornet player, or my great grandfather was a cornet player too. So it was just one of those things. As a little kid, you thought, "Oh, my dad did that. That's cool," and it stuck.
Yeah, for me, my mom played piano, and so I started piano when I was four. My older brother, started playing trumpet when he was in the fourth grade, and I didn't want anything to do with what my brother did. So I went to his teacher and said, "What should I play?" And he said, "Oh, you just look like you're a trombone player." So I got stuck with a trombone, and I guess it worked. But, you know, at heart, I think I'm still a pianist. So, Becky?
So I actually have to say, when I was in third grade and we were allowed to choose instruments for next year for fourth grade when we started, I had no idea what I wanted to play. I wanted to play something that was easy to carry around on the bus. So I wanted to play flute or clarinet or something small. And my brother said, he was much older than me, he was in high school, he said, "No, my friend's cool and she plays French horn, so you should play French horn." So I actually ended up picking French horn, and I think we all understand that feeling of, oh, this is something that really grabs hold of me, this is something I like listening to. And for all of your students, if they really like the sound of something, most likely they're going to want to keep playing it. So for me, I was really lucky when I started playing horn. I said, "Ooh, I like the sound. I like what's happening here. I like practicing this instrument." And so I encourage you, if you have a student who says, "No, I really like the sound," all right, well, go for it, because most likely they're going to keep playing if they enjoy it and they enjoy what they're actually producing. All right.
I'm the tuba player. All I did was I walked into the elementary school band room, and I looked in the corner, and I saw an instrument that no one else was picking, and it was huge, and it was old, and it was all dented up, and I thought it looked cool, and that was it. I picked it, and I've been here ever since. It's been awesome.
Well, that's a good one. I'm not sure I heard that one before. All right. Do we have any other questions?
Hello. Out of all the places you've been and all the places you played, what's been your favorite performance and the most memorable?
Oh, gosh. I've been in for 15 years, and we've traveled about 100 to 120 days a year, so that's a lot of concerts. Been a lot of really great ones. I'll just pick mine real quick. Someone said, "What's your coolest place?" Coolest place, and I'll say coolest because I actually, temperature-wise, was Barrow, Alaska. That's up above the Arctic Circle. We got to go to Alaska two different times in the last 15 years, and we actually took a C-130 military transport, two of them, from, I think down from Fairbanks, Centra, all the way up. And basically, Barrow is this tiny little Inuit Eskimo town. There's really not that many people there. The week before we went there, they had reports of a polar bear walking through town. It's like, oh, wow, we're going up there. So, but we got to play for these really appreciative people that they told us their stories about how they were going whale hunting the next day, because they have like a whale season specifically for them. But we played a concert up there. They were great, a lot of fun. How about anybody else?
So I've only been in the Army Field Band for a little over 2 years, but this past summer, over the 4th of July, we actually went up to Detroit and we played with the Detroit Symphony in Dearborn, and that was possibly one of my favorite performances ever. I really loved playing alongside the symphony, and I think it was a really appreciative crowd. We had the fireworks, we had cannons during 1812 Overture, we had lots of different things going on, and it was just a really fun performance. And also, the orchestra was so welcoming, and I made so many friends in their horn section and in other sections because we literally sat on the stage right next to them. So those poor violinists in the back row were right behind the horn players who were in the line of fire. So we had to talk to them a lot, and we just had such a great time up there. So that was possibly one of my favorite performances. Next, do you have any specific questions by any chance for our staff arranger, Sergeant First Class Adrian Hernandez? Questions about arranging, about ranges, anything?
Yeah, how did you get picked by the Army Field Band to do their music?
So how did I get selected? It was a pretty arduous process. I'll go ahead and kind of go into detail because it's kind of interesting. There's an open call at the field band, and when a position opens, there's three staff arrangers on staff. The open call came out. It was posted over the across the United States, and what it involved was sending in your catalog of works that you've done, and through that, they were able to pick out a few to do a homework assignment. And over that homework assignment involved writing a chart for each of our four components. That's the jazz band, the rock band, the chorus, and the concert band. And from that, they determined four finalists that would come to a live audition. And at the live audition, you'd have an interview. And then also you have 8 hours to write a work based on a melody within a certain form. And after that 8 hours is up, whatever you have done is what's completed. And the next day they do the reading. And then I got a call back the next day saying I got selected for the position. So it definitely was a lot of writing in a short amount of time. And that's definitely one of the things about the job, is that there's definitely quite a bit of turnaround time when things are needed, because sometimes missions come up and they need a certain piece. And we work with the library and getting permissions. And then we've got to deliver so they can rehearse and have it ready. And that's really basically how I got here today.
Really cool.
All right, I think we have time for maybe one or two more questions. Any others out there?
So, hello, my name is Jillian. I'm actually a horn player, so my question is for the horn player. Right now, I'm playing an unaccompanied piece, and there's a section where it literally goes from playing fortissimo to stopped horn, and it's very hard for me to maneuver like that quickly. It's by Stephen Gritsch. It's a melody on a southern hymn or something like that. And it goes to a stopped B flat, and then it's an A flat passage. So what would you recommend on getting there quickly? Because there's no breath markings, and it's unaccompanied, but you still want it to flow. So
of course. Okay, so my first question is, do you play on leg or off the leg?
Well, I'm standing for this.
Okay, so if you're standing, you want to think about where you can keep your hand in the bell the entire time, that it makes a very easy hinge, if you will. So when I'm standing and I'm playing with my hand in the bell, just about from this knuckle to this finger is the only thing that stays steady, and everything else can move. So I just close my hand off. I worked a lot on trying to make a seamless transition from playing regular horn to stopped horn pretty quickly. And I found that if I just had a small part of my hand stay in the bell and stay connected with the bell, everything else could move and close off. That also makes you wonder, if your hand is in a position to go to stopped really quickly, maybe it's too far out of the bell. Maybe it needs to go farther in and be a little bit flatter. And I actually just recently was working with a teacher of mine, because I'm still taking lessons, I'm still learning. So I was working with a teacher, and he suggested a slightly farther in the bell hand position that made playing stopped a little bit easier. So those are a couple of things you can think about. Also, if you're transitioning from regular horn to stopped horn, keep as much airflow as possible going, because a lot of people think, oh, it sounds stopped, it sounds muted, it needs to be played like this, and then they get really tense. So still, you have a lot of piping and tubes and a lot of distance to cover to get air through this instrument and to get it out the bell. So you need to think about driving all that air, still continuing it on, and still making sure that it's nice long lines and focused air. That way you're not really cutting off the sound here before it has a chance to go through your instrument. So did that help, or do you have any other questions?
That helps a lot, actually. Thank you.
Wonderful. I'm so glad. Do we have time for one more? I think we have time for one more question.
You want to ask about the prayer or something?
Okay. All right. My name's Phil. how has any of your careers developed before you got into the Army Band, and how has being in the Army Band impacted your musical career?
Everyone's looking at me. I've been here with the Army Field Band just coming up on 7 years, but actually my military music career started almost 22 years ago, almost. I did my bachelor's music in trumpet performance at Ohio State University, and right after that, I auditioned for as a regional Air Force band. So I started off in active duty Air Force as an active duty Air Force bandsman. I was in two different Air Force bands, one out in Omaha, Nebraska. Then I transferred to the band in Europe, stationed in Germany. So I had about 9 years. Of traveling with those groups all over. It gave me a really good foundation. We had active brass quintets in both of those groups. So I think that for me was the key to a lot of my development as a musician was the chamber music aspect of it. After that, I decided to leave active duty and go back to school to do a master's degree. And I stayed in, it was an Army National Guard band all through that that period and even into my doctorate. So I got most of the way through my doctoral studies. Then I was just looking at job opportunities, either teaching, sending out resumes for college teaching jobs, and the Army Field Band had an opening at the same time. So I was just looking for employment and other musical challenges. So this is what that's how I got there. So that's the short version of it.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right. I think that's all the time we have for today. All right. Thanks.